morning. Welcome to Hardin County Commissioners Court. Today is Tuesday, March the 27th. It is 10 a.m. and all members of the court are present. This meeting is called to order. Everyone please rise for the invocation followed by the pledge of allegiance.
Dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for all the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. I pray that you watch over and guide us and direct us as we go about the business of this county. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner. Item number three, Glenda Austin, County Clerk, requesting approval of the March 13, 2018 regular meeting minutes as presented.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Roberts and a second by Commissioner Pell. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number four, Deborah McWilliams, County Treasurer, requesting the court to cancel all registered claims from the March 13, 2018 regular meeting as presented. Good morning, Ms. McWilliams.
The amount of the liability I'm asking to be released of is $1,227,557.18.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Pell and a second by Commissioner Cooper. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number five, Deborah McWilliams, requesting approval of cash statement as presented.
In our general checking account, we have $1,812,947.97. In our investment account at Wells Fargo, we have $1,992,792.02. In Texpool, we have $12,594,323.64, for a total cash fund of $16,400,061.63.
Ms. McWilliams, can you reread the general checking account balance?
$1,812,945.97.
Thank you, ma'am.
My brain wasn't with my numbers, I guess.
It's okay. Just wanted to make sure we had it right.
Okay.
Move we approve.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Cooper and a second by Commissioner Roberts. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number six, Deborah McWilliams, requesting approval of quarterly report as presented.
This is for the fourth quarter of 2017. Our ending balances as of December 31st, 2017, in general checking, we had $3,080,847.14. At Wells Fargo, the investment account, $1,742,388.79. And in Texpool, $6,078,377.04, for a total cash funds of $10,901,612.97. So this would have been an increase in the cash for the fourth quarter of $2,245,528.25. On the third page from the back, I also gave you a report of the total interest we earned on the Texpool account for the year including January through December of 2017. We earned $65,918.96 in interest.
Very good.
Move we accept the quarterly report.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Pell and a second by Commissioner Roberts. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, Ms. McWilliams. Item number seven, Angela Gore, County Auditor, requesting approval to pay county bills as presented. Ms. Gore?
Our expenditures for March the 13th through the 20th is $10,935. The expenditures for Commissioner's Court on March the 27th is $808,721.45. Attached is a list of additional bills to be approved in the amount of $294,253.64. The total expenditures and transfers is $1,113,910.09. The gross payroll for March the 29th is $434,630.04. Your total transfers for your March 29th payroll is $530,495.93.
Move to pay the county bill.
Second.
Have a motion by Commissioner Cooper and a second by Commissioner Roberts. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 8, Glenda Austin, canvassing of votes for the March 6, 2018 primary election. Ms. Austin, how are you this morning?
I'm fine. The parties did not send me anything to with results on that.
Who? The parties?
Parties, yeah.
Right.
And they are the ones that canvassed.
So I move to table item number 8 to the next meeting.
Second.
Motion by the chair and second by Commissioner Pelt. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 9, introduction of newly hired personnel. First, we have the county attorney's office. Ms. Walton here, good morning. And you're going to introduce Matthew Minnick.
Yes, Matt Minnick comes to us. He has 3 years at the Liberty County Attorney's Office. He's been an amazing benefit to our office and has really lifted the spirits around the courthouse, so we're glad to have him. He's done a great job for us. And then
welcome to Hardin County. And then Deneen.
Deneen Schmer.
Schmer, yes. Yeah.
She is our child diversion clerk and our part-time county attorney clerk, and she actually has about 10 years experience out of Sunny Cribb's office, so we're very fortunate to have her and what she can bring to the office as well. She's a pleasure to work with also.
Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you all both for being here. In the county clerk's office, we have Alyssa Freeman. Ms. Austin?
I do not think Alicia come. She was with customers.
You probably got her working.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She was with customers.
Well, we're glad to have her, and if you get an opportunity in the future,
she's
you might
very,
be introduced her.
She is a very good employee, yes.
Great. In the district clerk's office, Robbie Hiller. Good morning. How are y'all doing?
This is Robbie Hiller. She comes to our office as our new criminal clerk.
Welcome to Hardin County. Glad to have you. And then in the emergency management department, we have Ms. Michelle Brewer. If you'll stand so everybody can see who you are. This is Michelle Brewer. She's our new disaster recovery director, and she's hit the ground running and helping lots of people. I don't know if she's keeping up with how many people, but it's a bunch, and I appreciate the job you're doing, and I know everybody else does as well.
Definitely. You're doing a great job, Michelle.
Thank you. In the juvenile detention center, we have Ronnie Taylor. Mr. Taylor? I've seen him a lot here lately. Welcome to Hardin County. Welcome back. And in the purchasing department, we have Stacy Eukert. If I'm saying that right, I hope so.
Eckert.
Eckert, I'm sorry.
We're very fortunate to have Stacy. She started with us maybe a month ago and has learned a whole lot and catching on fast, so I'm very, very excited.
Welcome to Hardin County. We're glad to have you. And in the sheriff's office, we have some new corrections officers, Andrew Lang, Michael Langley, and Ty Rolls. Chief?
Yeah, the sheriff said apologize for not being here. He's in his chair right now, so we won't change places. But we do have several. This is Andrew Lang right here. Michael Langley is not here. I think he's actually working right now. Ty Rolls is on the end. This is Ben Rolls' grandson. So we got several Rolls. We also just hired his dad here several months ago.
Yeah.
Getting all those rows up. This is Gary Mann in the Bay Sheriff. He's retired from the federal prison system. He came to us. And we're glad to have all those in, with us as corrections officers. On the deputy side, Daniel Atkinson worked nights last night. He came from us from Cargan Police Department. Young guy. And like I said, he worked nights last night. Michael Nolan, he has came back to us. He left and came back, but he was not able to make it either. And then we have Ms. Helen Blewett, is our new dispatcher right here. And I go in here and they said, oh, I'm glad to see you made it back.
She just keeps coming back.
That's good. That's good.
You know what I'm talking about. And the same with these corrections officers. They put up with a lot of stuff, and we're glad to have all of them.
Mr. Lang was in court this morning, did a fine job. Appreciate him. Thank you all for being here. Welcome to Hardin County, and welcome back to some of you. Item number ten, special recognition of personnel by the department head for meeting years of service. First, we have Ms. Monica Kelly. Ms. Kelly, you want to meet me up front?
Monica's been with us for 25 years. How did you start out in the probation department?
Started out in adult probation, seven and a half years, and went to juvenile probation.
And now she runs the place and does a fine job doing it, and I enjoy working with her. Thank you for all you've done for lots of kids in Harvey County, and I know you've got a lot more to do.
We do.
And we appreciate you very
much.
A lot
of work. Thank you.
25 years. Laura has been recognized today for 15 years of service. She is currently the director of the Hardin County Crime Victims Assistance Center. She's been doing that for a little over a year, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And is doing a fine job there. I appreciate what she does. Tell us how you started out in Hardin County.
I came to the auditor's office as assistant auditor, was there 14 years, and then went over to crime victims.
We appreciate all she's doing, and hopefully you got at least another 10, right?
I hope.
Chief, you gonna recognize Captain De La Serta?
Yes. Okay, this is Scott's 10th year with the Sheriff's Department. He started as a jailer, then he went to patrol, and then he went to sergeant, then he went to lieutenant, and now he's gone to captain in the jail. And his next move would be chief deputy, and we're going to hold on to that for a little while. Anyway, Scott's done a great job. He's moved up, obviously, to different positions, and he now is running the jail, which everybody knows that's a job, big job. And he's doing a great job, and we just want to thank him for 10 years of service.
He had a good FTO.
Yeah.
All right, item number 11, Debbie Mendesauble, Human Resources Director. Discussion and possible action to approve job description for part-time clerk in the county attorney's office.
So moved.
Have a motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Pelt. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 12, Laura Pate, Director of Crime Victims Assistance Center. Consideration of Resolution 13-18 for adoption, recognizing April the 8th through the 14th, 2018, as Crime Victims Rights Week.
So moved.
Second. Have a motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Roberts. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. We'll have it ready for you in just a few minutes. Item number 13, Amanda Young, Floodplain Administrator. Consideration of two resolutions for adoption as follows. 14-18, to abandon certain roadways in Western Townsite Company subdivision located in Sour Lake, and 15-18, to abandon certain roadways in Richard Rogers subdivision, also located in Sour Lake. These abandonments were previously approved in Commissioner's Court on January the 16th, 2018, and you need these resolutions for, what's the reason? The appraisal district needs them?
Yes.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion by Commissioner Pelt and a second by Commissioner Roberts. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 14, Amanda Young, discussion and possible action to approve and accept the final plat of Rock Creek Ridge Subdivision Phase 4 located in Precinct 3. Yes, ma'am.
We do have an approval letter from the engineer. This is the fourth phase of this subdivision. They've done a very good job.
And I've inspected it, and I'm moving with it.
Second.
A motion by Commissioner Pelt and a second by Commissioner Cooper. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Number 15, Amanda Young, discussion and possible action concerning Rock Creek Ridge Subdivision Phase 4 located in Precinct 3. Consider and possibly approve the request to enter into the warranty period. Accept the security bond in the amount of $11,875.72. And authorization to sell lots.
I so move, and the on this one here now, we're going under the 2-year warranty, 50% completion, right?
Yes, sir.
Have a motion by Commissioner Pelt and a second by Commissioner Cooper. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 16, Misty Sims, purchasing agent. Consider and possibly approve solicitation of statements of qualification for jail medical services, and if approved, appoint a committee to evaluate submittals received and make a recommendation to Commissioner's Court. Do you have a committee ready to appoint for that?
Sheriff Davis, Scott Delacerta, and Judge McDaniel.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion by Commissioner Cooper and a second by Commissioner Kirkendall. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Number 17, Misty Sims, discussion and possible action regarding recommendation from the evaluation committee concerning statements of qualification for engineering services for all disaster recovery and mitigation projects associated with TX 4332 disaster, which is known as Harvey. Ms. Sims?
Move to accept the committee's recommendation.
Second. Have a motion by Commissioner Pelt and a second by Commissioner Kirkendall. Any discussion?
Yes, sir.
Commissioner Cooper?
Mitzi, do you know what they base their decisions on? I've sat through these evaluations before, and going through all the information that these companies provide to us, it takes a lot of time and everything, and I certainly have high faith in the committee, but do you know what they based this on? What was their final? Did Mr. Pelt and Mr. Roberts sit in on?
Yes, sir.
We sat in those.
Was y'all satisfied with everything?
Very.
Okay. And we've done work with all three of these, I assume.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's all, Judge.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. I want to thank the committee, if any of the members are in here, and thank you, Commissioner Roberts and Commissioner Pelt, for handling that and getting it ready so quick. Item number 18, Misty Sims, discussion and possible action to award bids for purchase of materials and emulsions for all road and bridge departments.
Mitzi, before you start, are you just going to read the ones that were awarded the bids? I mean, this looks...
Yes, sir. I have a couple things to talk about on two of them, but otherwise I'll just read the low bid.
Thank you.
Seal coat aggregate, Vulcan Materials quoted an item that I wasn't sure was met our specifications, but after a little bit of research, I think they do. I put that with y'all so you could see it. So there's this Texot item 302 type PB4 at $21 a ton, and then Gulf Coast at the plant for $68.25.
On the seal coat, it's Gulf Coast for both.
Well, I wasn't sure if that material met specs, but I believe it does.
Yeah. Yes, because that's going to be the same TxDOT standard for.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir. So we want to award Vulcan at the plant and Gulf Coast at, I'm sorry, yeah, Gulf Coast delivered.
Yes.
That's fine.
Next item is hot mix asphaltic concrete pavement. Gulf Coast was $58 at the plant. LD Construction's $58 at the plant. And then delivered would be Gulf Coast at $62.75.
Vulcan did not bid
at the plant, huh?
No, sir.
Or they did not bid hot mix, period?
No, sir.
LD and Gulf Coast have been going back and forth. It's like Gulf Coast has won this one. Can we do a number one, number two for availability?
Yeah.
And award Gulf Coast number one, but also award LD number two, just in case there becomes an issue of supply.
Yes, sir. Next item is hot mix cold laid asphaltic concrete pavement. Vulcan, they also submitted a bid for item 330 type D plus, and we asked for item 334 type D, so I'm not sure if those are the same things, but it doesn't really look like it to me. Okay, so the apparent low bid would be Gulf Coast at the plant, $61.25, and delivered $67.50.
Wait a minute, Vulcan. That's $44 at.
It's not the same material.
Well, it's not the same material.
No, sir, I don't think so.
And Apex does not bid?
That's Gulf Coast.
Oh, that's, they've changed the name, okay.
Is anybody familiar with that 330 type D plus?
I'm familiar with the term type D, but not the 330. So type D is just like a cold mix asphalt. They've used it before for like patching potholes and stuff.
Or equivalent road material. Vulcan materials at the plant, $21.50, and $28 delivered, and it's also $28 delivered from Knife River.
Cat didn't bid.
They contacted me late and it was later in the day. Somebody missed it. On slag coat products, no bid. Coverstone, Gulf Coast delivered, $53.75. Knife River at the plant, $45 a ton. Grade 4 3/8 washed pea gravel, Martin Marietta is $32 at the plant, delivered $39. Field dirt had no bid, Pine Ridge sand no bid, Rye Base no bid, Bahama Base no bid, Rapid Road Repair, LD Construction at the plant is $83, delivered $93. 1-inch washed limestone, Vulcan materials, $28.50 at the plant, and $34 delivered. Crushed concrete, Gulf Coast at the plant, $18. It's also $18 at Knife River. And delivered Gulf Coast for $24.25 a ton.
Are we going to do a number one and a number two on this one as well for availability purposes?
Think, yes, sir.
So Knife River will be number two for delivered, I'm sorry, for the plant?
Yes, sir.
While you have a break, back up to the pea gravel. The plant, Martin Marietta, is 32, so they're low bid there, but both companies have the same price for delivered, so that would be equal.
Yes, sir.
So we could use either or.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Martin Marietta at the plant is $40 and delivered $48. And then OPF 42 aggregate base, there was no bid. X-Seal 550 S&S supplies at the plant, $18.05 a gallon and delivered $19.05 a gallon.
Got a question on that OPF 42 aggregate base. That's the ash.
I believe so.
Yeah, I think there's only one company that does it. So.
Thank you.
Do we need to get the road oil bid?
Wrong
seat. Thank you.
Emulsions, bids for emulsions were open on March 15th at TPU in the purchasing department front office. Myself, Stacy Becker, Amanda Nine, and a representative from Cleveland Asphalt were present. Emulsified asphalts SS1, CRS2, CRS2H, Cleveland Asphalt at the plant, $1.40 a gallon, delivered $1.53 a gallon. Asphalt item 300 AC10, Martin Asphalt at the plant, $1.50 a gallon and delivered $1.63 a gallon.
We have always deferred to sending our trucks to Shepherd versus Houston. And so would that be the pleasure of the court this time as well?
So we would award Martin Asphalt for the plant, and then the number one would go to Cleveland Asphalt for the delivered?
It'd actually be opposite, Judge, if we go to the plant to pick it up, because mm-hmm. on the minimums for delivery, most of us don't have tanks that big.
Okay.
And so we've got to go pick it up, and we've always just tried to make it a habit to keep from driving those trailers to Houston.
Martin Asphalt would be the delivered price, $163 a gallon?
Yes, sir.
And the number one for delivered would go to Cleveland Asphalt at $205 a gallon?
At the plant, yes, sir.
I'll get it right here in a minute.
That's okay.
Is that the pleasure of the court? Everybody in agreement on that?
Yes, sir.
For the plant?
This one?
This is number one for delivery.
Next item is Road Oil MC800. Martin Asphalt, $225 a gallon at the plant, delivered $238 a gallon.
I'd like to do the same on this as well, if we can. This is pleasure of the court.
Can you specify that
yes,
way you
sir.
Get it right and I don't say it wrong?
On the road oil, if we have to go pick it up, that we would award Cleveland Asphalt at the plant for $2.60 a gallon. If we have it delivered, Martin Asphalt out of Houston. Yes, I don't think a lot of us are using the AESC 300 anymore, so.
That was the only bid you got on that one, right?
With Martin and Cleveland.
Oh, Cleveland did bid on it, yeah.
The next one is Prime Coat AEP, Cleveland Asphalt, $190 a gallon at the plant, delivered $203 a gallon. Tac Oil RC 250, item 300. Cleveland Asphalt at the plant, $255 a gallon, delivered $268 a gallon. MC300, Martin Asphalt at the plant, $275 a gallon and delivered $288 a gallon.
Is it MC300 or 30?
30.
I'm sorry, MC30.
Okay.
And the last item is Cracked Fuel Oil, Brine and Brine Asphalt at the plant, $565 per ton and delivered $580 per ton.
I move we award the bids as presented and amended in court.
Second.
A motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Cooper. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 19, Misty Sims, permission to solicit bids for disaster emergency monitoring services and disaster emergency debris sites.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Cooper. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Number 20, Misty Sims, discussion and possible action to authorize the county judge to sign a one-year pre-event contract with Ashbridge Incorporated for disaster recovery services.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Roberts. This includes debris removal and the other items that are in their current contract. It just extends it for 1 year. That would take us through August of 2019, is that right? Okay. Any other discussion on this item? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion passes 4-1. Item number 21, Misty Sims, consider request to authorize the county judge to sign a copier lease agreement with Xerox Corporation for the county jail and AgriLife Extension Agent's office.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Pelt. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 22, Commissioner Ken Pelt, Precinct 3, setting a public hearing to consider the following. Abandonment of certain roadways never adopted in Old Hardin Townsite in the Butler Hughes Survey, Abstract Number 277, and in the Hardin County School Survey, Abstract Number 248, as requested by Logan A. Carter, and abandonment of a certain roadway never opened in the Old Grayburg Townsite in the Mary Jones Survey, Abstract Number 336, also requested by Logan A. Carter.
These are roads that were never developed. They're old public roads. The law allows us to abandon them because they're over 75 years old, and we haven't plat signed by a surveyor certifying that the parties own all the land adjacent to them, so no one is left without a access to their property if they would so buy property.
How long do you need to advertise that? 2 weeks? So we could do it at the right before the next commissioner's court meeting, or is that enough time?
Don't believe that's enough time.
I think we have to do it at the next one on the 24th, right?
Correct. That's what I've told the people.
What time?
9:45.
Do it at 9:45 on April the 24th. Is that good with everybody else?
Yes, sir.
All right, so that public hearing will be set for April 24th at 9:45 a.m. Does that need a motion?
Set public hearing. Okay.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Felt and a second by Commissioner Kirkendall. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item number 23, discussion only of any item not on the agenda without taking action. Mr. Cooper, could you update us on the annex building project?
Yes, sir. We had our biweekly meeting this past Thursday, and as of right now, the projected date on completion would be April the 16th. I walked over yesterday. They started laying the tile. The generator came in. They have it installed, and Energy was out there hooking up electricity, so we're moving right along on that. The setback right now is, and the contractor's saying it's due to the storm and can't find workers, but the floor layers, the actual laborers who are laying the floor, they've lost a lot of their workers, and they're working on it, but they don't have as many as what they anticipated. So one thing that I will say to the court, I don't know if I've expressed it to the court, I have to the judge, and I have to the ones involved in our meetings. If I ever go through this again, I would think, and I don't know how Mr. Peltonham did it whenever he worked at the project at the jail, but instead of letting our architect use their engineers, I would say we hire our own engineers, because this electrical engineer that we had in this project cost us time. And everybody that's looked at that, the air conditioned systems and the generator out there, says it's overrated. And he says it's because of code. It might be. I don't know. I'm not arguing that. But I would definitely, if I go through this again, would want our own engineers, because that was one big setback for us. But we're moving right along. Hopefully we'll be in it by the 16th.
I hope we don't have to go through this again.
I hope not either. I hope somebody else does, nice. But not us.
Thank you, Commissioner Cooper.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Kirkendall, do you have anything?
No, sir.
Mr. Pell?
Nope.
Mr. Roberts? Anybody else have anything?
I just wanted to say one other thing. It didn't include anything about the annex, but I have met recently on a couple occasions with the county clerk, and her, she's having some problems with her voting machines. And my suggestion to her was to collect some data on what she has that needs repaired, on what needs to be replaced, to see what we can do in this next budget cycle, because these machines are very expensive. She might have got with other members of the court, I don't know, but if we don't have the money to actually replace any of these machines, we might have to reduce the number of voting sites that we have, and I don't think that, I think we looked at that before, and I don't think that was a very popular issue. We definitely can't. She's going to get some numbers on prices for me, but we definitely can't replace all of them. But some of the ones that do need to be replaced, there's a possibility we can get renovated ones from the company. So I just wanted to bring that to the court's attention whenever budget time gets here.
These are the machines that we got under a grant many, many years ago.
With a HAVA grant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
TWIP.
Of course, that's not available to us anymore.
That's what I'm
saying.
And those machines are obsolete, so you can't replace them. Yeah. It's the first I've heard about refurbished machines, so that's good. If we have to replace any machine, you got to go to the new model, which doesn't work with the old machine, so that ends up being a problem.
Yeah,
and some of the
you wouldn't be able to buy just a few of the new ones, because they won't, like George said, they won't work with the old ones.
And by law, you're obligated to have machines, right? Yeah, that's what I say. You know, when they passed the law, they gave us a grant to buy them.
Yeah.
But now you have to start replacing them. You have to do it.
I think by statute, we're only required to have the ones for the handicap.
Yeah, we have to have one in
but you have to have
all polling places.
We have to have one at each voting place.
That's all we have, isn't it? One at each place.
We probably won't have that in November, because we had about four or five that went.
But if the county decided to go paper only, we could not do that by law?
Oh, you have to have a voting machine.
You could do that and just have that one handicap one.
How many are we putting in each voting spot now?
Oh, the handicap, just one.
That's what I say, we only have one. So we're not talking about having any more than one.
So what if a handicapped person wants to vote paper, do we not let them vote paper?
Oh, yeah.
But some voting places have a handicap machine and then maybe one or two other machines, right?
Some of them have all.
You're bigger, larger.
And then also talking about the machines, and I just learned this with my limited knowledge of that, but on the machines, when you walk in, that identify the, if you're on the roll or not, it's electronic. According to information I received in 2019, all of them will be obsolete.
Those are gonna be obsolete.
That's not counting the voting machine itself, but the data machine itself.
Now, wasn't the presentation that was given by Hart, wasn't it close to $1 million?
It was 900 something thousand.
So it's quite a big expense is what we're talking about.
But again, I reiterate, the legislature passes laws, or the feds, and you get a grant to start with. But then it becomes the burden of the local taxpayers.
Yes.
And yet then they want to set caps on how much you can raise taxes to pay for this stuff. And the people need to understand that what's happening to us and driving up local taxes is not local decisions we make, but decisions that are made and forced upon us.
The unfunded mandates.
And along those same lines, this refund we just have to give, or fiscal to have to give, because of a unanimous decision by an appeals court on these, the equipment?
Yeah, the equipment.
We're fixing to have to fork over
oil compressors.
$80,000, I think.
Which the appraisal districts went to the committee meeting and was in favor of it back when they passed the law. I've got that on my desk.
Also, maintenance on the machines that we have now for this year is going to be almost $17,000.
Move adjourn.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Pelton, a second by Commissioner Cooper. Adjourn.
That's a good one. Hey, I talked to Neil Paul. He said he'd be on that committee for the training.
Okay, I'll be right there. Thank you.
You have just a minute.
Amanda.
I need to talk to you. Oh.